All right, this is John Cola with growingyourgreens.com. Here with another exciting episode for you, coming at you from a beautiful spring day here in April. And this video is being filmed in April 2017. Not sure when it's going to air, probably in May at some point, because I'm kind of backlogged with a ton of videos that I want to pump out for you guys until this one come out. But anyways, the reason for this episode is because it was about 3 years ago in April 2014 when I got an irrigation system installed in this very bed, and actually this whole side of my yard. And for those of you guys who have been watching me for a while, you know, this irrigation system, the Aquajet irrigation system, may have been quite controversial. You know, there's people that saw the original videos when I installed it, and you know, they were like, all right, John, that looks like a great idea. And some people, like the MI Gardener or Luke, poo-pooed it immediately. That's like, that's a bad idea, it's not gonna work, and all this stuff. And you know, whatever you guys think is cool, because everybody's entitled to their opinion. What I want to do is I just want to show you guys what happened and my experience with the Aquajet over time. So if you're curious about the whole saga, be sure to check the links down below. I'll post links to some of the videos that I've made with the Aquajet, you know, the original install, maybe dialing in the install when I did it, you know, on one of the back beds myself. Some of the challenges I've had over the years with it, maybe not watering appropriately for certain reasons, but now it's been 3 years, and I do have to say, overall, it's definitely been one of my techniques that I use to be successful gardening here in the desert, where it is such an arid climate. If you guys live in a, you know, tropical climate that's like really moist and wet all the time, that might be different, but I live in an arid climate. I mean, here, look at this. The top of my soil here, I mean, this is just like sand. It's so dry up on the top, and things dry out really fast in the air. I mean, if I had just drip irrigation on the top here, you water, and within a couple hours, all the water on the surface level has evaporated off. And this is basically wasting your water, because it's not getting it to where their plants need it in their root zone, right? So they could take it up, they could transpire, they could cool themselves off. So this is very critical gardening here for me in the summer in excess of 110 degree days. You know, I've been through two summer seasons with the Aquajet now, watering in the summer. And I do have to say that the side under the Aquajet system where I underground water always does better than the other side of my garden that I don't have it. Now, that could be because of a few reasons. Number one, the subsoil irrigation, the Aquajet, it conserves water. Number two, it also, as the Aquajet is in there, every time it comes on, before it actually pushes out the water to do the watering, it pushes out air, which actually feeds the beneficial microbes in the root zone, which just makes sense if you're into organic biologic gardening like I am. So it aerates the root zone, causes the microbial populations to basically grow faster so that they could do their job breaking down some of the organic matter and nutrients to make the plant available. In addition, on this side of the yard, I do have to say I probably have better soil on this side than I do on the other side. But despite having better soil, I still believe in my heart that the Aquajet has performed quite well and allows me to grow more effectively if it's dialed in properly. And let me go ahead and show you guys what the Aquajet is for those of you guys that haven't seen it before. This is the Aquajet tubing. You know, in the original video, I couldn't really show you what it looked like because, you know, it wasn't the patent was still pending. But now it's at a point where it's you know, good. But basically, the Aquajet tubing, what happens is the water feeds into this top chamber here. It fills it up. Once it gets filled up into the top chamber, the water then is pressurized into the bottom chamber, in which every 12 inches there's a little jet that basically pumps out water underneath the ground, so you don't get the evaporation on the top. And I know some of you guys like this idea, some of you guys didn't, some of you guys said, John, why don't you just go down to Home Depot and buy some PVC tubing, drill holes in it, and that's going to be the same thing. Well, you know what, that's not the same thing, because it's not the same pressurized tubing where you have two different chambers here. I mean, this has been engineered to work properly. And you know, whether you want to make something up yourself and try it, I'm all for you guys experimenting. I don't have time to be experimenting with everything in my life. I want to just, you know, try to put something in that's going to work, so that it frees me up to do other things, because I have so many things going on in my life. I don't have to worry about like figuring out my irrigation. So I got the Aquajet, and for better or worse, you know, it's been here. I would definitely say it's better, but I know a lot of you guys have some concerns over the years, like, John, on? Does that plug up, man? How does the dirt not get in there, clog up some of the holes? You know, how does it last? I mean, I'll tell you guys this, like, I was the first install of the Aquajet company, right? So in my garden, the piping that's underneath the ground has been in here the longest of anybody in the world for the Aquajet system. So that's why in this episode, what we're gonna do is we're gonna go ahead and dig up this Aquajet system in this bed, because I just pulled out my lettuce the other day and I'm about to replant peppers into this bed. But before I do, I want to go ahead and dig it up, and we're gonna check out a few things. Number one, when this Aquajet system was installed, granted, I didn't have the bed built. I kind of knew where it was gonna be. We didn't have the soil in, we didn't know the exact level, so it may have been buried a bit deep, which will adversely affect the Aquajet system. So if you do put in an Aquajet system, you wanna make sure that the hole where the water stream comes out is 4 inches below your soil level. Very important. Another thing that we didn't do at the time, because once again, I was our first install, and I like to be an early adopter, right? To learn if a system's gonna work or not. I mean, there's always three things that could happen. It could work, you know, just as good as existing technology. It could work worse, or it could work better. In my opinion, it worked better, but there was some challenges. So one of the challenges, they would install the Aquajet system, and because it was put in under all, you know, fresh laid compost and not existing soil, like most of their installations are actually for lawns that have existing soil, that actually the Aquajet's not gonna sink. Because the compost is nice and fluffy, over time, you know, the soil level sunk, so did the Aquajet. And every season I pile on, you know, you could see this went down a couple inches, maybe like an inch. I pile on new compost on the top. That means I'm burying the Aquajet always a little bit lower and lower, because it's probably moving down as the soil compacts down over the time. So this is another issue. So I want to make sure that this is going to be stable at about 4 inches below. So now they came up with some standoff that they could put in underneath there, so that's not gonna move. So we're gonna dig this up, see if there's holes. We're gonna make sure that this is at the right level, and it's gonna stay there. And the other thing that I want to do is, you know, I originally installed a racetrack design. So originally Aquajet had like one Aquajet down the middle, and they said it would shoot out 2 feet either direction. I don't know that I would trust it to do that, maybe with the right amount of water pressure. But so what I did was I put in, you know, one line here, one line over here, so that each line only really had to punch out like 1 foot, which seemed reasonable to me. And based on my testing over the years, there's a bed behind me that has the Aquajet in there, it's done pretty well. You know, I won't say that I have 100% coverage of my whole bed in some cases, especially because I like to plan out on the extreme corners of my beds. You know, some things near the exact edges may not get water, but I've learned to work around that. And so what we want to do in this bed is maybe optimize the placement of the Aquajet tubing, because sometimes my row would actually want to plant right where, you know, where the Aquajet is under the ground, and then that doesn't work for like all the root zone and everything. So we're maybe gonna space this in or out a little bit to help me out a little bit. But yeah, so I think those are some of the main things that we wanna show in this episode. And for this episode, we'll introduce in a little bit Rob, the owner of the Aquajet company, Intelligent Irrigation LLC, who's actually come up to basically take this out to inspect to see what happened with this system. Also, he's gonna, you know, because I was the first install, he wants to take out the system to, you know, make it better, right? He's gonna see if there's any defects, anything that's happened over the time, and he's gonna improve it. And also, you know, because now they're, I guess I was their first production run, they've had hundreds of production runs since then, over 800 customers in different countries around the world. You know, they've improved the product, including some of the molding process, so they have a more consistent product that's not going to be, you know, bend and do all this other stuff. So yeah, so let's go ahead and get Rob in, maybe have a few words before we actually start digging up this bed to see what happened with my Aquajet. So now I want to introduce you guys to Rob. He's the owner and founder of Intelligent Irrigation LLC, that makes the Aquajet that actually was here about 3 years ago in my garden to do the initial install. And, you know, much like anything, when you do something for the first time, it's not always right. And I will say that I did have some challenges that at one point Rob wasn't maybe the most happy about. And once again, check the links down below for some of those where I kind of just show my experiences. And that's all I do. I don't try to make stuff up. I show my experiences, because here's the thing. I figure if I'm having some experiences with the product, right, many of you guys are also going to have the same experiences with the product as well. And I want to encourage you guys to do things to avoid the problems that I had so you guys can get successful results. And, you know, once, or, you know, my problems that I have might be isolated to me. That might be John Kohler problems because I'm weird or something like that. And that's, you know, hey, I totally accept that. But anyways, I'm glad that Rob's back here today, and he's going to make sure that this is operated correctly. And, you know, once again, like I said previously in the other video that I made with him, I'm going to show exactly what happens after this new secondary install. I will say that on this bed here that we're going to dig up today, it's worked really well. You know, I don't want to say it's perfect. I'm going to say it worked really well. Generally, I grow things like lettuce and peppers and brassica plants in this bed. And I think the main thing is with the Aquajet for me, because this was buried a little bit deep, initially when I plant my plants out from transplants, I do need to do some supplementary water, because right as I put them in, the roots are not established yet to go down as deep as where the water is. In addition, on one end, you know, where the pipes come up out of the ground and it goes in the Aquajet, it's a little bit too deep. So then I find that, you know, some of my plants were getting stressed out. Some of my peppers on that side in the inside of the bed never got water. So unless I supplementary watered every year, I would lose the peppers on that corner because it wasn't getting the water for some reason. So hopefully we're going to get that worked out today. And Rob, do you want to have any, say any new comments about your new upgraded version here after being in business now for 3 years and doing a ton of installs and having 800 customers now?
Yeah, you know, it's when we first came to John back in 2014, being the first installation, it was also new to us. It's everything works on the drawing board, but you need to get it in the field, in the ground to see how it works. And that also includes the installers who we got to, actually we got to use John for a good practice session putting it in. But yeah, he's right. It was a challenge putting it in here. A couple of things, like you said, the beds weren't built, but we still knew the you know, where we got it the best we can. It ended up being a little too deep on this bed, but we've been able to monitor it through some of the videos, and we could see what John was talking about and some of the stress, but we could also see what a great grow that the bed had, you know. So he did lose a couple plants, but he also grew a couple thousand, so I think that was okay. But anyhow, through the years, we strive to improve the Aquajet. We're not a company that wants to come out with a product that we think is the best on the market and rests on our laurels, especially the Aquajet being new. So there's a few things that we dialed in on the extrusion process. We worked with our extruder to make it a more of a perfect system, to work out some of the nuances that you really don't see with the naked eye, that we as developers and creators of the system knew that was going on. So we worked with him and our molders and improved the system, you know, kind of like tweaked it a little bit, so you get a better form of the Aquajet. The first one we put in here had a little bit of humps. When the part would cool, it would cool down and it would hump just a little bit. We were able to straighten that out. Just a hair of a twist we were able to straighten out. So little things like that, and with John's input, it really helps us, because what we need, it's kind of like racing. You know, when you're out there racing, you need the driver to go out there and do the testing and come back in and tell you, the builder, what to do and what's best. So we've been able to form a relationship with John, and we think that he is the most knowledgeable gardener in growing and raised beds in the world. So it only makes sense to come to John and get his input and feedback on what he thinks what type of improvements that we could make with the Aquajet. We do have one coming up later that John will talk to you about, but that's what we're doing. And so we want to thank John for his valuable input, because he's not going to sugarcoat. If it's not going to work, he's going to tell us it's not going to work. But at the same time, if it works, he's going to tell you that it works. So that's one of the reasons why we came to him, because, you know, it's almost like a company getting a third-party study. They'll pay $30,000 to a accredited university to get some, you know, documentation about their part. Well, if I pay $30,000, I don't want to see anything bad, and they don't get it bad. So what you do is you get a part that may fail, but in the meantime, you got gardeners and farmers who are buying it based on this third-party study. So input from John is very valuable, that we get exact and true input, and we don't need to be told that we have a great part. What we need to be told is where the system can be improved at, and then go from there, which is why we're here today, because we're going to dig this up. It's been 3 years, and we want to do an inspection. We know that John's been growing great lettuce and peppers in here, but that's not enough because you can't see the system. So we're doing an inspection, and at the same time changing it out, putting a new one in, so we can inspect it here. We can take it back to our shop and do some more inspections to see what's been going on over the years. I'll take a section to our extruder, let him look at it and see if he notices anything going on, and then move from there. And at the same time, we get to improve this bed because we got the soil, we got the measurements, so now we get the right height and watch how it grows from here on. So there's a couple other things that we're going to be trying with John, but the main thing for us as a company is it's very important and valuable to have somebody like this that could test the product and give you the feedback that you need to do the improvement, so that you, our customers, are able to buy a better product than a product that just keeps improving, unlike a drip system, where the drip systems know they have inherent clogs, they know that they have heat coming up here, but what do they do about it? It's been around since what, the 1930s, right? So, you know, this is what we need. So with us, we figure we're almost like a Formula One race car builder. John is our driver, and he gives us the feedback, and thanks to John, we're going to make this the best product in the world.
Awesome. Yeah, and hopefully all you guys too, you know, with every product you guys buy, I've had some challenges recently with some composters and whatnot, but hopefully every company will watch this video and other videos and take criticisms, not like, they're wrong, I'm right, but hey, how can we improve and always improve the products, you know, improve the quality, like they've been doing over in Japan with some of the Toyotas and Hondas that are some of the most long-lasting cars, and unfortunately most American cars still aren't getting the quality up and improving the product as much as they could be, in my opinion, over the years. So yeah, I like companies that really try to improve and push the market forward, because I mean, everybody uses drip, right? I'm like, oh, John's weird, he uses this Aquajet. Well, hey man, Aquajet, in my opinion, is better. Look at this. This is the bed that actually has the Aquajet. You would never know it's there. You would never even know there's an irrigation system in this bed. And that's what one of the things I really like. There's no pipes on the top, nothing that looks weird, it doesn't look funky, it looks nice and clean. I can plant wherever the heck I want. I don't have to worry about running into a pipe. I don't have to worry about like making sure a drip emitter is right next to my plant. The whole thing gets watered. So anyways, Rob, let's go ahead and get into this, start digging this up, and showing my viewers actually what happened after 3 years.
Great. All right, so as you guys could hear, the audio is out. I lost the audio, the wireless mic ran out of batteries or was not working properly, so I'm going to do a voiceover on this for you guys. Basically, what happened was Rob had dug this out, and we found that it was sunk down a little bit deeper than it should have been because standoffs were not put in. Despite that fact, it was working pretty good for me over the years that it was in. The next thing we want to do, though, because some people said it might get clogged up, the dirt will clog the holes, we're going to go ahead and expose this some more and see if we could find any clogs or any holes that got plugged. So yeah, let's check this out. All right, so we got it unplugged and we're gonna go ahead and fire up the jets and see. All right, so all the jets are firing except for one right there. So yeah, one hole was plugged.
All right, so as you guys could see, Rob has been busy working pretty much all day. He's got this totally dialed in, set up exactly as I want it. He got it actually exactly 4 inches deep. He's got a set of four different standoffs in there, so it's not gonna sink any deeper. In addition, he's like plumbed the lines, and actually he made the Aquajet to my exact specifications, which should be about 10 and 3/4 inches from the wall. The thing that was happening is when it was a little bit closer, how we had it spaced out before, like I would usually plant 5 rows in here, and the row second and the fourth row would always end up right on top of the Aquajet. I dig with my digger to put in my transplants and I'd hit it. So now I've offset it. So now I could put the plant in right to the side. And yeah, so it looks pretty good. We're going to go down to the end and show you guys what we did. A little bit different than the racetrack design. And also we're going to go ahead and fire it up and show you guys the new setup. And then we're going to sit down with Rob and talk to him a little bit more about the improved Aquajet, and also what he's learned over the several years that he's been selling and installing them. So one of the challenges I've had in the past with the Aquajet is that it always seemed like the corners and some of the extreme edges in some cases were not getting enough water. Now, one of the challenges why that occurred, in my opinion, is that it was too deep. So it was 6 inches deep instead of 4 inches. So we got that corrected. In addition, this edge here, which we would call the racetrack design because it kind of goes in a racetrack, we just had a solid pipe here This time we improved it, and this is kind of just for experiment to see what happens, if it works better or worse or the same. We actually just put another Aquajet in between this connection piece, which is in some ways not necessary because there's already going to be good water disbursement in the middle, and then the side might get some. Otherwise, we'd usually run this to the wall and then run it there. So it might get a little bit better water coverage. The other interesting thing we did was we teed off here, and then we kind of have it going out a little bit. So this is going to ensure that we get, you know, some nice jets over here so that the corners that I left the plant in are going to get water. So I guess with that, let's go ahead and move the camera one more position and show you guys the full install and fire this system up. All right, so as you guys can see, the system is fully engaged. And one of the cool things about the Aquajet system is that right before it comes on, it pushes air out of the lines, which is good for your plant's roots as well as the bacteria and all the different microbiome living in your root zone that need oxygen to survive. You guys can see it's coming on, and this stuff really soaks. I mean, it takes full pressure, but the thing is, unlike a drip system, they gotta run for 10, 15, 20 minutes sometimes. You only need to run the system for like a minute to get the volume of water out into the bed and get it dispersed. You guys can see all the different holes are running, and if we lift this up, you guys can see it's spraying everywhere. Whoa, and we got a cross spray over here. It's kind of cool. But yeah, it looks really good. We're gonna go ahead and turn this off, get all this buckled up, and we're gonna sit down, talk to Rob, the owner of Intelligent Irrigation LLC. So you guys just saw the new installation that I got on the Aquajet. Now I wanna say this first off, you don't need to pull up your Aquajet every couple years and replace with a whole new one, right? We just did this because Rob, why did we do this, Rob? Tell everybody.
Well, you know, the company is 3 years old now, and this is one of the oldest installations for 3 years. So it just behooves us to see what's going on with the Aquajet. In other words, we want to know, because it's in the subsurface, we're confident with it because we've seen how your bed grows the peppers, but still until you actually see it. So what we want to do is replace that bed and now take the whole Aquajet back to the shop, cut it up and inspect hole by hole and look at the inside, see if there is any dirt or residue or anything like that and see what's going on, because you don't know unless you do inspections. You know, and if you assume that something is working just to the way you expect it to, then it's a bad thing. It's like shooting yourself in the foot. So what we want to do is inspect this and move on. And we'd like to do it again maybe next year with one of the other beds, and because that will be the fourth year and the fifth year. And we know that a five-year span of non-clogging is very, very important. Mm. We're three going on four. So everything is working out to the way that we designed it on the drawing board. But putting it in the field, as you know, is different because, as you can attest to, when we first put it in here, there were things that we needed to improve on a couple of issues, the installation and installation procedures, the Aquajet itself. But that's not abnormal because that's a new product. It, like you said, it worked great, but still there can be some improvements, and we will always be looking to improve not just the Aquajet itself, but the way it functions. And an important part of that is you and your experience with the Aquajet and your feedback that you give us, because that's highly important, because this is what's in the field. You were the longest standing customer running it, you know, season after season, nonstop.
Yeah.
So we're able to pull a lot of very important information off your installation, which is what we need for our feedback and, you know, the improvement of the Aquajet. I don't think anything is ever perfect. I think that the best model of any device can use improvement.
Absolutely. Yeah, I mean, I definitely say always strive to improve your gardening ability, your diet. I mean, if you're a manager or owner of a company, try to improve your product or service, or, you know, in this case, actually the irrigation system that they're working on improving. So I'm glad that he pulled it out. He's gonna take it home and inspect it to improve the product. And now the other thing is that, you know, of course, I got my system dialed in. I got it at 4 inches, so now I can't make any excuses if it's not working properly. I'm sure I'll see actually even better growth because now the water will really get to where it needs to be. I won't have to top water as much when I put in my new baby transplants. So Rob, another question I had for you is, like, for people that live in the East Coast, not here like the West Coast, we don't get like freezes here, right? And so I know a lot of places that, like on the East Coast where they get snow every year, you have to flush your pipes and get all the water out of the pipes or you're gonna bust stuff up. You know, do they need to flush an Aquajet system because it is underneath the ground, and will it freeze? And have you had customers back east that may have had this problem or issue?
Yeah, we do have customers back east, and we've had them back east since 2014, and that's a constant question we get for people in colder climates. For people like you and I who have grown up in warmer climates, you know, when someone first told me about blowing the lines, it's like, what are you talking about? Why do you blow the lines, you know? But no, the Aquajet doesn't have to be blown, because the Aquajet drains and the water will drain from the system. Because, you know, when the pipes burst, when the water freezes, it's the thawing out of the water and the gases that expand that explodes a pipe. So, but that being said, I would still blow your lines. And the reason why is because your feed line to the Aquajet's going to hold the water. You know, so if you're coming from a valve underneath to the Aquajet, chances are that that feed line between the Aquajet and the valve still has water. So it's not the Aquajet that you have to worry about, but I would blow your lines for the feed lines. But no, the Aquajet has lasted, well, now going on 3 years in the winter weather. And that's a very good question. And that is one of the other things, like I said, on the drawing board, we didn't think that there'd be a problem in freezing weather because there'd be no water in there to freeze. And that has held true. However, like I said, the feed lines still need to be blown.
Sure, sure. And so you've done hundreds of installs in the last couple years, Rob. So what have you learned over the time you've been installing these to share with my viewers? Like, maybe they were going to buy one and they're going to install it. What would you recommend that they do to make it a painless and good install so it's going to work properly for them?
Right. Well, I think the important thing is, and some of the things that we do in getting feedback, is a lot of the customers out there have given us feedback on the way that they do it, the way that they make different standoffs, the way that they do insulations, and we've actually learned some from some customers. But for ourselves installing, you know, we've learned a lot like anybody would, you know, when you first start out. You know, even though the Aquajet's an easy insulation, there's still technical aspects that you really, like you said, you don't want it too deep, you don't want it twisted, so you have to have it right, and that's one thing we learned. Another thing that we learned is when you cut the Aquajet, because number one, we highly do not recommend cutting it with a PVC saw or any other type of saw, because it causes a bunch of little burrs, and that's going to get in the Aquajet. Even though you flush it, they will stay in there, they will get in there, and they will find a hole, and they will clog. So what you do is you use PVC cutters, because it's a clean cut. You know, I think $10-$15 set at Home Depot is your less expensive ones. But what happens when you cut it with PVC, you cut it, it's a clean cut, but the PVC causes a ridge in the PVC. So when you look at it, you see this ridge, you can actually feel it. When that has a ridge and you try and put an adapter or a coupler on there, it's almost impossible, because it just won't go. So what you need to do is take that burr off. And what I do is I just use a sanding block, and I sand forward. I don't sand in, because I don't want to drag anything into the Aquajet. You know, I sand forward, I take that burr off, and then I make sure that the coupler adapter fits on before the glue goes on. And if it goes on even just a little bit before the glue, then you're good to go. You know, but you definitely have to deburr it, or you'll sit there and fight and get frustrated and whatnot. So deburring after you cut is huge, and of course, the flushing. And the reason you want to flush after you deburr is in case you get any debris in there, that's going to push it out.
Cool. Yeah, I mean, the other things, if you are going to install an Aquajet yourself, take your time, make sure it's all level, and make sure it's to the right. Make sure it's level, like, you know, this direction, so you don't want it spraying funky. And, yeah, make sure all your holes are lined up so they're, you know, equidistant from the edges of your bed, because that's the part that, you know, might not get enough water if, like, your hole's off. And like just the one we did right now, I think near the corner that we did the new corner, it maybe had like one jet, and we had a good 12-inch run where there's like no water getting there the first time. But, you know, improve. So Rob, another thing that I want to talk to you about is actually some other improvements you've made in the product since the time you installed it. Like, what has changed in the product specifically to make it better?
Well, there's a couple of things that we've improved on in the processing of the Aquajet, and of course that is the holes, which are highly critical. You know, there's a lot of things going on with the size of the holes. If the holes are too large, you can actually have a washout in the soil. You're putting out more water, stressing the system. And so what we did is we improved our emitter holes. They're actually a little more perfect and a tighter tolerance, so to speak. We were able to do that with the adjustment of how we drill the holes. Of course, everything is jigged, and we adjusted the jig, and that helped. On the extrusion side, we were able to improve the way that it is extruded. That is the main manufacturer. Extrusion is when the pipe just comes out of an extrusion die, and there's a lot going on there, because as it comes out of the extrusion, it's coming out hot.
It goes into a vacuum that pulls the sides out. And with the Aquajet being the dual tube, it's a very tough extrusion, but our manufacturer is top notch, and so we improve that also. So it's a matter of, we mentioned the race car earlier, it's a matter of bringing out a race car. It's not going to win. You need to go out and do some testing, do some improving, and then it's ready to go. And that's kind of like the Aquajet. It came out, it's a good product right off the bat, but as anything that's new, if you're not looking to improve or looking for anything that might be a little bit off, then you know you're hurting yourself and the product. So those little fine-tuned things with your help and letting us know the Aquajet, the deepness of it, the twisting and the effects that has and how critical that is. So those are some of the things that we're able to improve on the manufacturing side and on the processing side.
Cool. So I mean, I, in a heartbeat, would put an Aquajet in again in a system if my system was set up properly. Like, this is not really set up to do in circular beds like the other side of my yard is. But if you're just doing standard raised beds, I would use this before I use a drip system. And to me, it's just clear. Number one, it's easier to deal with the soil and planting plants. You could plant them wherever you want. They don't need to be next to a dripper hole. Number two, it looks clean, man. I just like the look of the Aquajet. You just don't even see the irrigation, especially in times of drought that we're coming out of because of all the heavy rain last winter in some places. You know, it conserves water. That's also very important to me. I like the fact that it actually aerates the root zone and feeds the microbiome, so you could have more vigorous and better growth. But what would you say, Rob, if somebody's considering buying a drip system, like why should they consider an Aquajet instead of a standard drip system?
Well, because a standard drip system is going to just drip on there, and it's going to drip on the surface, and then you have a lot of evaporation going on. Number one, they're susceptible to clogging from hard water because the water's sitting in there. And when a water's sitting there, like the water sits in a hot water tank, that chemical reaction with the calcium, that is what causes that hard water and those molecules to form. The Aquajet, because it drains of the water's not in there, and that's why it's not susceptible to hard water clogs. Another thing that we like about the Aquajet is the utilization of the nutrients in the root zone.
Oh, right.
Now, we got the aeration going on, we got the water going on where it should be, but most important now is the nutrient delivery system, and that's our fertilizer injector. And you put that on the front end, and now you have the ability to charge your, or recharge your garden. Actually, it's like, you know, as you know and learning from you, as you're going through the growing season, you're burning off a lot of the nutrients in the uptake, the trans-evaporation and things like that. So the ability to put more nutrients in as you're going through your growing season, I think, is very important. And of course, you will find out because that's one of the things that we're going to utilize with the Aquajet here in your installation is a fertilizer injector. And once again, the important thing about that is your feedback.
All right. Yeah, cool. Yeah, so the fertilizer injector, I'm really looking forward to that. Be sure to click the subscribe button down below for a new episode on the fertilizer injector install. Once I get that going, also Rob is going to redo another area of my Aquajet install that has had some challenges in the past, so that'll be a really good episode to look forward to in the future. I think I'm really looking forward to the fertilizer injector install because basically that's going to allow me, because I travel so much, I don't want to spend time, you know, watering and adding cool things like trace minerals from the ocean and different, you know, compost teas, like manually. You could just put it in this little injector and then it automatically will inject it through right into the root zone where your plants need it. So that's definitely really cool. Rob, any other final comments or things you'd like to share with my viewers today before we have to sign off?
Well, I think the cool thing about our upcoming installation is an idea that you had that we're going to try in your garden right here, and we're not going to give away what we're going to try.
All right.
But it's something that it's not your idea that you came up with, and you came to me and said, Rob, I think that I'd like to try the Aquajet like this. Can you do this for me? And we looked at it and says, yes, we can. And that's obviously going to be a prototype where you're going to put it in and grow the whole season and then get back to us and let us know, yes, it was better or the same or it wasn't as good.
Right. Yeah, sure. Yeah, I mean, that's the other thing. You know, I mean, I could bounce ideas off Rob and he's willing to, you know, put some money into a project to make this new prototype for me to see if I could get even better growth out of the Aquajet. So stay tuned for that upcoming install and learn more about the new prototype that's going to be coming out. So Rob, if somebody wants to purchase the Aquajet, after all my experiences and testimonials for it, How could they do that, and what's the special discount for my viewers today?
Okay, you know, and I'm glad you asked, because with the Aquajet, what we do for our viewers is the shipping. And as you know, shipping cross-country can, you know, be expensive. So what we do is we cut the Aquajet into 4-foot lengths. Anything over 48 and the price really starts going up. So that's one way we keep it affordable for our customers. Another way is we search out the lowest price for shipping between FedEx, UPS, and the post office. And because they do vary, and sometimes they vary by quite a lot. So what we try to do is keep it affordable in that way. And we're sensitive to shipping prices and how that adds up to the total cost. Now with the Aquajet, the thing is, with when you order, you can order online at www.intelligentirrigationllc.com. And when you order off our website, what we do is we cut it into 4-foot sections, unless you supply us with other directions saying I want it in 5-foot lengths, 10-foot lengths, whatever, you know, that we can do. We box it up, we ship it, but we don't know the shipping price until the actual product is boxed up, because in shipping it goes by what zone you're in and how much the box weighs. And the Aquajet orders will always vary a certain amount of couplers, adapters, filters, and whatnot. So what we do is we put the order together, we weigh it, measure it, and then we search out the lowest shipping price, and then we send a customer a request for shipping, and then after they pay that, the product is shipped off.
All right, cool. And what's the special discount for my GYG customers?
Okay, so special discount for the GYG is we're going to set that up on our website, and we're looking at... Well, we're going to talk about that, you and I, because he's a tough negotiator. And if I tell you what the discount is right now, what he's going to do is say, that's not enough. I want more. So what we'll do is we'll negotiate you a discount, and on the next video, you're going to let him know what that discount is, right?
All right, cool. Sounds good. Yeah, or just check the links down below. I'll probably have something set up for you guys so you guys get the best price on the Aquajet if you guys want to put one in yourself. I mean, at this point, I could definitely recommend it. You know, definitely want to pay attention when installing it, but it does work properly. And we didn't even get to talk about water timers. So that's another whole other issue about the Aquajet. You got to make sure you have the appropriate water timer that could time in seconds, not minutes, for best results. Anyways, enough of this episode. It's getting dark. The sun's already down, actually. I got to go in and eat some dinner. But if you guys enjoyed this Aquajet episode and want that other one really soon, hey, be sure to give me a thumbs up. I'll try to get that up sooner rather than later. That's going to happen in a week or two. Also, be sure to click that subscribe button right down below so you don't miss out on those new upcoming episodes that are coming out about every 3 to 4 days. You never know where I'll show up or what you'll be learning on my YouTube channel. And also be sure to check my past episodes. Once again, all the links for my previous Aquajet videos are down below. But check my past episodes, over 1,250 episodes at this time, teach you guys all aspects on how you guys could grow your own food at home. So with that, my name is John Kohler with growingyourgreens.com. We'll see you next time. And until then, remember, keep on growing.